Speaker Dr. Roy, you know, very much for this highly educational and illuminating, you know, piece of talk. You know, in a short time, you explained many important things. And so we should thank you very much from here first, before you go to the question and comments the hour. So you could, you know, now, please, you know, raise your hand if you have any questions or comments. And we'll see that somebody takes the microphone, you know, to you. How was the microphone? Can I ask you questions in the meantime?
Yes, please.
I know tsunami is one of the major after effect, also scary very much. You didn't say much about tsunami actually. So maybe would you like to say a few words to the audience?
Yes, tsunami tsunami is an after effect. It's a secondary hazard related to earthquake. All earthquakes do not generate tsunamis. Tsunamis are generated only if the earthquake focus is, you know, on the oceanic floor, the epicenter is on the ocean floor, and the earthquake is associated with ground uplift or subsidence, as I have shown in the case of in the Andaman area, but there were large-scale ground uplift and subsidence. So if these conditions are fulfilled, then only tsunamis are generated, and the tsunamis, the hazard affects only the coastal area. The people living within the present day sea level, 2, 3, or 4 meters, because that is the maximum the tsunami height. Of course, there are records of tsunami wave heights reaching 12 meters, 15 meters, and that high. But this is a hazard associated with our coastal areas. And this hazard can be avoided if we avoid building structures in the coastal area. It's rather easy. So, and moreover, this is a secondary derived hazard. So that's why I didn't, because that is also a great hazard. Many people die because they do not follow these guidelines and avoid coastal areas for developmental or residential purposes.
Thank you. Now, please now pass on the
point. I have got 2 or 3 questions, very small. I want to know the need, where the source of the earthquake is, how it is determined, everywhere within certain cities or places this seismograph is kept, or how it is known, number one. Number two, number 2 point is the, what is the parameter from 0 to 10 scale in the Richter scale, how it is determined. And these are the main 2 questions, and afterwards I will.
Okay, it's not necessary to put the observatories in the cities. You can have observatories at different places, but you know it is the travel time, and from the travel time, to know the velocities of POFs and SOFs, their arrivals are recorded on the seismograph. Seismograph is a continuous recording measure. So I know that only one observatory cannot determine. Only 2 or 3, three minimum, and more the number, more accurate is the determination. If there are many observatories where they are recorded, so from there you can know the how far is the source from this area. So just by intersection of circles or spheres, you can determine that area. So that's why from multiple observatories you require, and from seismic data in multiple observatories, you can accurately determine the focus, hypocenter and epicenter. And your second question was, what is the Richter scale and different scales? Richter scale is not used, although in the media and widely, if it's everyone refers to it, say, so much Richter, 5, 6, 6 Richter. Richter is, it's a measure of the magnitude. It is called local ML. There are different scales of magnitude, ML, MB, MSB. MB is the body of magnitude. S is the surface oil magnitude, but most commonly used, and what in my presentation I have used, is that the seismic moment magnitude. These are the, we'll have to go very deep into science, that seismic moment, the 1 to 10 is the maximum, so we have the scale limit, and from that, as I said, up to 4, we do not feel it, and 4 to maximum recorded, instrument recorded earthquakes are 9.3 1964 in the Alaska, Chile earthquake in in the 60s, and our Sumatra is the third. These are the last nine earthquakes, but luckily for the humankind, these are all offshore earthquakes. So these are the different scales, and magnitude is in the, you know, is the combination of the, in the scale of Richter, the amplitude of the waves, and in other cases the magnitude, you know, moment, that means the area multiplied by displacement. So these are the different criteria which are taken into consideration.
Now, would you please restrict the questions to one, because we'll make people...
Yes. My point is if the earthquake is happened in North India, America can observe this in any of their missions.
Yes, there are worldwide, and the farthest it travels, the more is the distortion in the waves, and the more is the error in detection.
Sir, I have just two questions. First one is that I came across a report where there was a statement that Kathmandu is located on primitive lake basin that amplifies seismic wave energies. Why is this so? That one, that gave rise to such a devastating earthquake in Nepal. And second one is that what do we mean by sleep movement? I didn't get that. Sleep movement.
No, that is. I do not know why the earth, because it is in a valley, Kathmandu Valley, because it has amplified. That also is subject to, you know, further examination by science. Because, you know, as I said, that S wave is the most damaging one. S wave is a shear wave; it cannot travel through the softer medium, and it cannot travel through liquid. So, in case of valleys, we have soft sediment. So, in earlier years, we used to read that in the case of valley fields, the waves, S waves are first attenuated. But sometimes people say that's why I said that we must put strong motion axiograph in different areas, so to verify the some of these things which we just utter without thinking much, how much this is correct. How these Rajarhat area buildings and how other areas, the buildings, the vibrations are magnified or attenuated, how it affects. Because in USA, they have determined that only the shear wave velocity in the top 30 meter, that is the only significant parameter for our earthquake design. So VS30 is the only parameter they are measuring all over their country, USA. So, I know that there are differences in opinion about the whether the valley fields, how do they behave, and whether they are multiplied or not. That is why they should be multiplied and how they are multiplied. These are just offense statements.
Sleep
means, you know, on a fault, the earthquakes occur when along some plane of weakness, the one block moves with respect to the other. This way, that way, and all that. So the total amount is called sleep. In case of Andaman, which had generated the third largest earthquake, instrument recorded earthquake, the sleep was about 20 meters. So only 20 meters sleep can generate so much of, delivered so much of energy that almost it affected the Earth's, you know, rotation system. Even. So most of the sleeps are hardly 1 meter, 2 meter, even centimeter scale sleeps can generate the earthquakes which you mostly feel. But more than 5, 6, you know, in meter sleeps can be very, you know, damaging.
Okay. Next question, the microphone here.
The earthquake
in
Nepal, the speaker's presentation has been very significant. On his last item of retrofitting structures,
is the microphone on by any chance or not?
Yes.
Hello. The retrofitting has been done in some of the developed countries very well.
particularly on the western coast of the United States, and even the Golden Gate Bridge, which were designed pre-earthquake detailed knowledge stage, have been retrofitted about 7, 8 years or 10 years back. So retrofitting as a part of structural earthquake engineering. What I mean to say is now the knowledge has developed in various allied fields, and the earthquake engineering by itself is a specialist subject. As a structural designer, I find that even we have to learn from them, we have to learn from the engineering geologists and the kind of personality these students, learned professor is, speaker is. So what I want to focus is this: the knowledge has so much of interactive areas. We cannot, simple question and simple answer cannot give us the totality of the knowledge. The only feature is this, that there is another way approach, that whether we can be safe or not, it is for to the extent the civil engineering design group, which also specializes in structural and foundation engineering, they have to collect among themselves to produce certain definite prediction. This is the whole situation. Yes.
Retrofitting, you know, as I said, that whatever civil engineers are thinking and whatever they are designing, those are applicable only to the future structures that will be built. What do I do with the structures that I have already exist or are in place? And we know those are, at that time when these were built, the adequate seismic vibration considerations were not put into the design inputs. So for those buildings, for those structures, only way out is retrofitting. So that we can again put something here, something there, some truss here, something there, so that to make it strong. Now retrofitting is being considered only in case where the risk is high, because where the maximum, say, large halls, factories, buildings, bridges and all that, so that where, you know, risk is very high. Now for individual dwelling units, whether you go for retrofitting or not, that depends on the affordability also and the some of the building structures. And even after retrofitting, no design engineer can certify that this design, I have retrofitted it, so it will survive any magnitude of earthquake. No, it depends on the magnitude and shock we prepare it for, fit it or retrofit it. Retrofit is again retrofitting. That means we have already completed the structure. We again try to improve its performance in that. Second one, I think this was his main issue, that retrofitting, and retrofitting is being done in India. But, you know, so far, you know, even design engineers were thinking the put on rollers, base isolation. I have seen building structures being designed in the Northeast that the foundation and other things should put on rollers. But if the rolling direction is at a very high angle from the wave, from which the wave are traveling, it will not be effective. So there are limitations. Now people are thinking that not rollers, if we have a socket type of joint. So those are the different things on which people are thinking.
Next question is then.
Dr. Ray, my question, or rather the observation, goes to Japan. On your presentation, it was obvious that Japan is highly vulnerable to earthquakes, and there were many red dots all over the Japanese continent. Would you like to comment or any lessons would you like to recall from your experience and wide erudition? What are the Japanese people doing so that the high-rises that are made in Japan and the transport, rapid transport systems that are in place there, they are not that affected, although there are earthquakes practically every day of different magnitudes.
As I said, that they have improved. You know, in India, compared to the magnitude, the damages are disproportionately high. A 6.8 Latu magnitude caused 8,000 casualties, but in Japan, probably that would have not caused any damage, because they, for many years, they are trying to design structures which can withstand damage. But in spite of that, we had Kobe earthquake, or several thousand died in Japan. So even with the advancement of the knowledge and all things, no structural designer or even art scientist can say that this country is absolutely, we can reduce the damage, we can reduce the loss of life. Japan has done to some extent. More advanced is probably Mexico, where from they say that we have the safest building we have constructed. So the earthquake affected countries are all trying hard, but we have not reached a final solution that this is the design, this is the for such and such magnitude earthquake. Yes, Japan has to lessen the risk to the damage, and they have improved like that, more improved design structure, designing structures which can accommodate earthquake, because that is the one of the worst affected parts of the earth surface by earthquake. So they have improved, they have made, but not absolute.
If I may add a little bit to what you said,
yes.
They designed differently. In like US and California, you know, particularly the earthquake prone zones, you know, they design buildings specifically by law, sensitive buildings, which may have nuclear materials or some other dangerous things, the 8 or 9 Richter scale design. So because of the design, you know, they don't, you know, even if the strong earthquake, you know, it can withstand. 6 is very common in California, 6 in the Richter scale actually. So they design it for 8, 9 to withstand. It's a tremendous difference between 6 and 7.
It's a logarithmic scale, 6 to 8 of the 100 times. So in our country, I can say at least, you know, the modern 6 magnitude, local magnitude, Richter scale magnitude, 6 magnitude earthquake is not going to cause much harm. And the type of only in areas like Latur and other places where people are so poor, they cannot afford even masonry structures. They just put stones and then stone blocks on the as a thin blocks.
One point, Mr. Ray. The duration also is important. In case of Latur, the duration was pretty long. It was 15-20 seconds.
15-20 seconds is not much of duration. You know, from the P to... Andaman earthquake's total duration was 2 kilometers. The fracture propagated, it depends on the fracture propagation. Andaman earthquake's fracture was about 1200 kilometers. Fracture propagates about 2 kilometers per second rate. It about 12 minutes, 15 minutes, the vibration continued. So duration, of course, duration, until unless there is a resonance, if the peak ground acceleration and the PGA and peak ground velocity has been taken into consideration, if there is no resonance, it will survive, irrespective of the duration.
But what happened there? Did you change? Resonance took place.
Resonance, that is something, as I said, that this, why some buildings remain unaffected? All the buildings do not crash. All the buildings do not fail. And it's not always because of the deficiency in the part of the civil engineers. So there we have studied, and the research is going on. When I was in GSI, I have studied that the characteristic ground frequency, every ground has got a characteristic frequency, and every building has got a characteristic frequency. So, these frequencies, if they should not match, that is the
understanding. What are the kind of waves that you have encountered there? Yes.
VS we have not measured in that. In our country, some stray VS measurements are there. And VS measurement, the difficulty is that it needs, if the best measurement should have been possible if there were explosives. If we explode, the artificial explosives are used and these shock waves are measured. But that's
but
something.
Please, next question is let you ask.
In India, what is the latest shift? In India, what is the latest system? Or appealing the people, or warning the people regarding the earthquake, but you have told that in British design, they have adopted, the siren system. But what is the present latest system of helping the government people regarding the earthquake? What is the latest system adopted in India?
Well, that is, need doesn't arise because we do not know even 1 second before. As I said, that only some progress we have made because of the difference in the velocities of P and S waves. Only 5 seconds to 4 seconds if we are, say, 100 kilometers away from the focus region. So in that case, I had just suggested in one place at some certain meeting or in government meeting that we can revive the old siren systems because that is the fastest and the easiest way to alert people. If someday, if we find that P and S wave difference will, even those 5 seconds are important. But that is more important for switching off critical systems like atomic power, thermal power or subsystems that can be used. So that is one subsystem people are thinking of, everyone giving everyone SMS alert or giving in the TV and all that. People are thinking over that and people are trying.
We're coming at the end. Okay. Quick question.
Please elaborate a little bit about how
you
please elaborate a little bit about how do we measure the local magnitude about 5 or 6, etc. What do we mean by it, actually? We say that earthquake magnitude 9, a magnitude 7, magnitude, etc.
Well,
in these are local magnitude. But
local magnitude.
What do we mean in terms of physics or like this?
The S wave amplitude 100 kilometers away from the source area, if it is 0.01 millimeter, it is 1 magnitude. That's how Richter was originally defined. And if it is 0.1 millimeter, it is 2.3, like that. It is 0.00, it starts with 0.001, 100 meter away from the source area. Now, we do not calculate all those. There are standard templates. How much, what is the distance, what is the magnitude in the, on the seismograph, and from that, in those templates directly, in any standard textbook, you will find the how to measure ML, local magnitude, that is the Richter magnitude. It is a measure of the amplitude.
If you don't mind, I'll ask the last questions, because I live in Salt Lake, which is in marshland. And he said that, you know, all this liquid stuff underneath makes it more prone to earthquake. So everybody puts in a pile in Salt Lake houses when they build it?
No, even not for earthquake consideration, because the load distribution, the civil engineers drive piles deep with the 10, 15 meters for high rises.
But our buildings, regular buildings.
No, buildings we don't do.
So it may still.
So these buildings are vulnerable, susceptible to these liquefaction. Because liquefaction is the most dangerous and most commonly affected.
Shouldn't the government make a law so that everybody should put a pile in someday?
No, the better would be to do soil testing, the ground testing, SPT, standard penetration test, and to see whether there is a liquefiable sand layer very close to the earth's surface and the depth of the water table. So two things are required, liquefiable layer plus water saturation. If those are not there, so I think we should put more money into the soil test SPT values and then we'll decide what sort of foundation we should have.
Okay, thank you. So I think it's a very you can ask later, actually he'll be there outside, so you can have to let the staff go. Thank you very much for this wonderful talk.
Thank you.
All of you can ask questions outside.